I'm very pleased that you invited me to let me share you my life experiences with you. This is a condensed version, though. as you know, I'm not a public speaker, so if I fumble a little, please be patient with me. And I also very shy of microphone. A friend of mine told me that how to get over that. She said, just picture everybody in the room, they're sitting completely naked. So I will try this. And with this, I like to begin. I was born in Page, Hungary, and so was my father. He and his family were in the Jewish faith. My mother also lived in Page, but was born in Szeged. It's a paprika country. Her family was in a Catholic faith. My parents met, and after a year dating, they married. Father and family were very unhappy about the marriage because she was Catholic. As time went by, they accepted her, and a year later, when I was born, the family got very close. I was raised in a Catholic faith, but from early childhood on, I always felt close to my father's family. When World War II started, my father enlisted in the Hungarian army. I was about 4 or 5 years old. It seems not too long after that, the Nazi Germany occupied Hungary. Because my father was a Jew, he was transferred from Hungarian army to a German prison camp. All Jews had to wear yellow band, and all political prisoners wore white band. They used all of them for hard labor for the German Nazi army because they were young and healthy. Treatment was the same, though, for all of them. Very hard labor, beating, minimal cleansing opportunity, and poor food. After the war, they find out that being in a work camp was a real blessing. It was much worse being in a concentration camp. The work camp, at least you had a small percentage of survival. At the same time, things get bad at home also. Almost every day, sometimes twice a day, the air raid started. The sirens were shrieking. It was loud and scared me. Each time, my mother gripped my hand in a large purse which contained our important papers and some emergency medicine, and we went running to the basement, which was nothing but a storage place for wood, but that's where all the neighbors huddled together. My mother thanked God each time for our survival. It was not too much bombing in that area. But the next day, the sirens started all over. It was horrible. Going to school was impossible. One day, my mother was sad and told me we are going to my grandparents' house to say goodbye because they have to go away. I remember seeing the yellow stars on their clothing and everyone was crying. I didn't know that was the last time I see them. They were taken to a ghetto where living conditions were inhumane and it was heavily guarded by the Nazis. One day we heard that the fence was taken down and was no people to be seen. We only find out after the war that they were taken to one of the many concentration camps. Soon a new law was announced. Jews cannot own musical instruments. It had to be turned in. A neighbor reported us to the Gestapo that we violated the law. We didn't turn in our radio and violin. So my mother, upon proof we were Catholic, they let us keep the instruments. When the neighbor find us out, they told us that they will have the SS soldiers taking us away because I was just a Jew brat. My mother get really scared. Her sister's husband was in a high-ranking officer in the Hungarian army. So he came for us. They had 8 children and lived in a large military housing. We were very, very lucky. After the war, We found out that midnight SS came for us. You can see how strong the anti-Semitism were those days. I was about 7, 8 years old then. The bombing where we moved was daily and much worse. In this area, one side was a military base, one side a railroad, and one side a major highway. One day, we had what later on was called the carpet bombing. Lots of bombers came, 3 times, 25-minute intervals, and just kept dropping bombs after bombs. I think they were trying to stop the German army movements. We were in the basement, 9 children and 2 mothers. The noise, the smell was unforgettable, as each time the basement door just kept flying open. It was like a nightmare. Finally, it was over. We all came up to the street, and the sight was unbelievable. There were only 4 or 5 houses standing. The rest of the street looked like a carpet. Injured and dead people were seen everywhere. After a while, inspectors came to check the still standing houses for safety. They found a large piece of bomb particle in our house. It passed through the roof, first floor, and stopped right above and lodged into the floor. If it has gone further, it would have killed all of us. God was with us. Soon after, my uncle had a new assignment and was ready to move with his family. So my mother and I moved to a more residential area. The air raid continued, the light sirens was just as scary, but there was no bombing there. One day we heard loud, strange sounding men's voices. They turned out they were Russian soldiers. This is a new nightmare started. 5, 6 soldiers came into the house, one with the horse. They acted like animals, ate and drank everything that smelled alcohol. My mother's cologne, the juice of a fruit compote with brandy. They walked around the house, and when they saw the toilet, they pulled the chain, and when it flushed and made a loud noise, they shot it with a machine gun. They never seen one before. We just couldn't believe it. My mother and I slowly started to back out of the house while they were busy roaming through it. And in the backyard, we started to run. By some miracles, they didn't follow us. The next day, we heard that they raped a woman and her 12-year-old daughter on our street. So for 1 week, we were hiding in different places. So did many other women in town and children. The Russians just kept drinking, raping, and looting. 1 week later, a Russian officer took charge of the city and put things back to order. This nightmare ended, so did World War II. I'm doing so far. We had no news of my father or his family. We just kept praying each day for good news. One day, the doorbell rang, and I opened the door. There stood the man, leaning on 2 canes, very pale, and looked like a skeleton, with very little hair. Then he said my name, my heart jumped, the voice of my father. We all 3 cried a long time, can't stop kissing and hugging. After that, we get back my father to good health, and we started to exchange stories. We told him about the bombing, our escape from Hungary, the Russians' arrival. He told us the horrible treatment of the Nazis and how he survived. One day, the Nazis started to shoot the prisoners. They were moving and only going to take the strongest one with them. There was a barrack where the sick, dying, mostly with typhoid prisoners, were kept. During the night, my father sneaked into the barrack and lay down with the sick people. He pretended to be dead. The Nazis moved out of the camp, and father lay there for a long, long time, waiting until everything was very quiet. Just then he came out of a barrack, started to walk down the road, but felt very sick and then finally he collapsed. A farmer who lived nearby found him and took him home. He got medical help. It took 3 months to get him back to health so he can start to travel home. We were all so grateful for the farmer. We tried to find out about the rest of the family, but the mail service was less to nothing.